Good afternoon, honorable guests. I began my journey with Amnesty as a volunteer. Some of my fondest memories were speaking to citizens at our malls about the abolishment of the death penalty. And this on-ground experience proved invaluable in having a pulse of what people were thinking and feeling. Too often, when we're in a position of power, we push paper. We have the right optics, but the substance and follow-up fall woefully short. Amnesty Malaysia came into inception in 1999. I am deeply thankful for those visionary pioneer members that started Amnesty here in Malaysia. We've come a long way, but we have a long way to go. As our report states, victories are to be celebrated, but with an eye to the future. Institutions and cultures remain stagnant and eventually meet their fall if they do not remain pliant, ever flexible in approach and change. As a result, the current Board of Governance has spent considerable time engaging the public, Amnesty members itself, and members of government and civil society organizations. Much like our chief guest today has said in the past, and I quote, "It is our duty to bring the people's voices and ideas into Parliament." Similarly, Amnesty Malaysia has mapped out a road to reform, starting with a radical leap in transparency and efficiency. The minutes of all board meetings are recorded and provided on a public forum and platform, and accountability is at an all-time high. A rehaul of membership structure is to be done so it becomes a very smooth ecosystem. And echoing Amnesty International Secretary General Kumi Naidu's move to both engage in creative ways of response to hardened state actors and a return to vigils and protests, the board is preparing to implement multiple trainings so that every person is empowered with a thorough understanding of human rights and able to hold forth whether on the LRT or at the dinner table. When I became chair, I spoke of how the image of activists was one of hardliners that come from a certain demographic and social economic status. At Amnesty, we are set to change that. From treetops to grassroots and in between, human rights is every single person's issue. Just as the sun does not discriminate who it shines upon, neither does climate change and air pollution, something every single person is and will struggle with. The Amnesty Board is committed to our ethos of sit, sign, and share. Malaysia can expect larger and more organized peaceful protests with citizens trained and equipped on how to witness and document various actions, thus increasing accountability of everyone. We aim to increase the signing of petitions, which time and again have proven extremely effective. And the sharing part of our ethos enables everyone to power a collective voice of what we will and will not stand for, the most recent example being the May 2018 elections. We call on the government to align itself with promises made and international covenants. My executive director, Shamini, who I'm so pleased to welcome back from London as a champion scholar in international politics at SOAS, should be speaking more in detail about Malaysia's human rights landscape. But briefly, freedom of expression continues to be an issue with negligible improvement. The criminal justice system continues to detain individuals under restrictive laws. Attacks on human rights defenders like Siti Kasim are examples that make us wonder if the government is once again just optics only. Police abuse, refugees, asylum seekers, and trafficking victims all continue to be a serious issue in Malaysia. Every day in my practice as a psychologist, I meet with individuals that are struggling with discrimination against LGBTQ people, domestic and sexual violence, and freedom of religion. I have met with clients both who have lost a loved one on death row and who've had a loved one who has been killed. Whilst emphasizing that these issues are some of the hardest that humans will have to grapple with, I, as chair of Amnesty Malaysia, remain steadfastly resolute in the continued call for the abolishment of the death penalty through evidence-based research. Pending abolishment, the Board of Governance is ready with a post-action plan that is thorough, compassionate, and pragmatic regarding the 1,200 or so individuals and their families that are currently on death row. I am thankful for each person in this room, especially the youth. So often I hear a sort of resignation in people's voices. I hear it at embassy cocktail parties, in therapy sessions, and even coffee with friends. You know, the refrain is usually some sort of variation of what can we really do? We can't make a difference. The problems are too large or too overwhelming. But each person here can make a ripple effect. To quote the prolific Japanese peace activist Daisaku Ikeda, "One thing is certain, That is the power of belief. The power of thought will move reality in the direction of what we believe and conceive of it. If you really believe you can do something, you can. That is a fact. As an organization, we are sowing seeds of cultural change. As a culture, we treasure the fantasy that someone is taking care of us, like a proverbial parental figure. We want our leaders to embody dignity and a sense of safety. Yet, for too long, women especially have experienced male entitlement, misogyny, and patriarchy. These things have never gone away, they have only buried itself underground, behind the closed doors of political and corporate offices. It has now reared its head through things like the Me Too movement, where women are challenging the status quo of suffering and silence. Our culture has tacitly winked at workplace inequality and misogynistic principles. As a result, it's no surprise that admired leaders behave erroneously with women. That behavior was culturally sanctioned enough for them to get away with it, much like Trump grabbed what he wanted. So one World Economic Report indicated, and that's in our report today, that it would take 200 years to close the gender pay gap. In 2019, Amnesty is determined to focus on women's rights and to increase a culture of mutual respect where misogyny dies to gender equality. As such, it gives me deep pleasure to welcome the record-breaking Member of Parliament, the Honorable Kasturi Patu. As the first Malaysian Indian to secure a seat in the Malaysian Parliament, she has been a force to reckon with, especially in regards to women's rights. I particularly smiled when I heard her think and question out loud the following. Times are changing and women are no longer limited by their gender. Many women are unaware of their rights, and it's our duty to be a voice, to be their voice, and to bring justice. If women can be the home minister and finance ministers in their families, why can't they be given a similar responsibility in ruling the nation? Thank you all for joining us, and I now call the Executive Director of Amnesty Malaysia, Chamani, for opening remarks. Thank you.